Hello there. My name is Rai Purdy, and this is a great moment for me to be producing the first television show from Glasgow Cross on New Year's Eve. Right now, we're at Theatre Royal, Glasgow, and this is the control room of Scottish Television Studio A. It is also, tonight, the nerve center of our telecast. Our outside broadcast van is stationed at Glasgow Cross, where the people of Glasgow traditionally gather to say farewell to the old year and welcome to the new. Gordon Arnold is in charge there, and his coverage of the goings-on will be fed to you through this control room. On our theatre stage, a party is in progress. May I show you? Ready to take it. I promise you some fun here tonight. Singing, dancing, and a touch of the kilt. Take four. Tonight, all over the world, people are gathering to celebrate the arrival of 1958. It will be with us in, well, almost exactly 29 minutes. In Scotland, this celebration is called Hogmanay. Here it is by far the most exciting event of the year. The Scots have taken the spirit of Hogmanay with them wherever they've gone throughout the world. Hit the film. Dissolve. In London, Piccadilly Circus looks like this. In Canada, Australia, in fact, throughout the entire Commonwealth, people will be celebrating. But the way they celebrate is largely influenced by Scots. Now, I'm a newcomer here, a Canadian. But years ago, my many Scottish friends in Canada gave me a very exciting picture of Hogmanay. It's a time when hospitality knows no bounds. Won't you join us? Here we go, as the saying goes, for a wee kick at Glasgow Cross. Come in, Larry Marshall. Take remote.
A little Tron Steeple cavalry. We've got everything here this evening you all really want.
Hey, and welcome to Glasgow Cross and the cold end of this telecast. But don't worry, we're not worried here because it's cold, because believe you me, we're having a wonderful time, and so far we haven't really felt it. And standing beside me, I have a man who is a complete authority on Glasgow. His name, well, Jack House.
Hi, Jack. Hello, everybody, and I must say it's wonderful to be here at Glasgow Cross, the centre of old Glasgow. And that old tower in the back there, the Tolbooth, was built in 1626, Larry.
That's quite a while ago, isn't it, Jack?
Yes, well, that's enough for history, I think.
Yes, I think so, too. Can you hear them in the background? Well, we're very pleased to say we have a crowd here, a huge crowd here, who are thoroughly enjoying themselves. They're over there listening to Bowie McLeod and his band. They're listening to the pipe band. They're really having a ball. However, let's see what's happening at your end.
Okay, thanks, Larry. We hope to have some community singing from there a little later on. It should be very exciting. But it may not be as beautiful as this. Ready to dissolve to two and dissolve.
We'll up and give them a blow, a blow. We're 100 miles
was the Phoenix Choir, one of Scotland's finest musical groups. Well, in just about 26 minutes, 1957 will be gone. You know, nobody can step boldly into the new year without at least a backward glance at the old. There are many things to be remembered, some of them wonderful little personal things. Some of them painful things. Some of them important things. Important to people all over the world. Let's look at a few of the big happenings of 1957. It won't take long. 180 seconds, to be exact. And remember, we have only about 1,500 seconds left before midnight.
At the year's beginning, Britain was still suffering from the Suez hangover. The United Nations was clearing the wreckage from the canal, and petrol was still on the ration. Ill and shaken, Sir Anthony Eden resigned, and Mr. Macmillan became Prime Minister. But soon there were other things to think about. Prince Philip made a gay tour of the Commonwealth and the Britannia. The royal yacht took him to Lisbon to join the Queen for a glittering state visit to Portugal. But the best tour of all was the joyous, tumultuous progress through Canada and the United States. The Suez hatchet was finally buried. And we mustn't forget the man who got his face slapped. America had heard domestic worries. The world looked on aghast as President Eisenhower had to send in troops to keep the peace at Little Rock. There's an uneasy quiet at the school now, but the problem hasn't been solved yet. More violence, and this time it's Britain's turn to worry. After nearly a year of quiet, Cyprus erupted again with riots at a Nicosia school. But the new governor, Sir Hugh Foote, has high hopes for the future. On the bright side, two new nations joined the Commonwealth as partners, Malaya and Ghana. Tragedy again. Just before Christmas, the appalling train crash at Lewisham, in which 89 people died and scores were injured. Only a miracle saved a third train from plunging into the wreckage. Scotland, too, had its sorrow. At Kames Colliery at Muirkirk, an underground explosion killed 19 men, Scotland's worst pit disaster in years. But above all else, in 1957, the minds of men were dominated by the skies. One great nation tried and failed to send a message into the cold blue of outer space. Now they are trying again, for this is, without question, the year of the Sputnik. From the two Russian satellites came the chill, eerie, persistent note of the signal going out to the world. Mankind had broken one of his greatest bonds, the immense drag of gravity. And as his ambassador, he sent a little dog.
Tonight in Scotland, tradition says you must have money in your pocket, food in the cupboard, and a fire which must burn in your hearth right through the night. It's a wonderful excuse to stay up all night. In Glasgow, tradition says you gather around the Tolbooth Steeple when the bells ring out at midnight. Take remote. The bells in this tower have been rung since 1830 by members of the same family. That's 127 years. And here's Larry Marshall again at Glasgow Cross with someone who knows all about this tradition.
Right just in time, because standing beside me is a young lady who officially tells Glasgow that now they can celebrate the new year, as if by the background noise you didn't hear them celebrating it already. Her name is Miss Jessie Herbert, and she is the official bell ringer. Would you tell me the correct word, please, Miss
Carillonist.
Carillonist. I was sorry. I was afraid to try that as well. Tell me then, Miss Herbert, how long have you been carillonist?
For over 20 years.
Over 20 years. And how do you find this job? You enjoy doing it?
Yes, I do enjoy doing it very much.
This, I understand, is a family thing. Am I correct?
Yes, that's correct. It's been in the family since 1830.
Is it 1830?
1830, yes.
That's quite a long time, isn't it? How long have you actually done it yourself, then?
Oh, since about 1935 or thereabouts. 1938, officially.
How many tunes can you actually play on these bells?
Oh, hundreds.
Hundreds?
Hundreds, yes.
As many as that? Yes. I didn't realize that. How many bells are there?
16.
16 bells. There's another thing I have to ask you here. You know, this is a very lowly position for you because normally you're about 126 feet above the
That's right. Above the
spot here.
Yes.
And tell me one other thing. How many steps up into this belfry?
132, specially counted last night.
Last night? Didn't you know before then?
I couldn't remember.
Well, there you are. Have you any special memories at all of New Year here or any other occasion in which you rang the bell?
There was one occasion a few years ago when one of the wires snapped while I was playing. And I had to finish playing a good New Year with one bell not sounding.
Which bell?
The G bell, the biggest bell.
The biggest bell of all. It would be the biggest bell. Well, thank you very much, Miss Herbert. Then I know you have to get up the steeple.
That's right.
So we'll see you later. Thank you very, very much.